Hello, good day, everyone. I hope you can all hear me. Did you enjoy that flightless tour of the amazing campus of Macquarie University? We didn't have to travel to Australia just to see that, so I hope you enjoyed it. By the way, my name is Monette, and I'll be your moderator for today. Welcome to our online session, Future-Proof Your Career. Skills essential to succeed in the industry 4.0 or 4.0. This event is presented by BADA Philippines, and we are an education company with offices here in Manila and Sydney, Australia, and an authorized agent of Macquarie University. Before we start, just a few housekeeping reminders. This session is being recorded, and you'll receive a link after the event, and we will send that to you via email so that you could rewind it or share it with people that you'd love to see the benefit of this session. Everyone is on mute and will stay on mute to avoid background noise. We also invite your comments or questions. Feel free to type them in the chat function. I've already seen those people who use the chat box. Thank you for letting us know where you're joining us from. Some people are from Ilocos Norte, Bacolod, so not just in Manila. Thank you. I'm not sure if there are people from outside the country. You are also welcome to this session. And this session will be running for about 45 to 60 minutes. And for those who are requesting for an e-certificate, don't worry. I'll be sending a request form link towards the end of the session. So kindly watch out for that. Okay. And it's a wonderful Saturday. I'm honored to introduce our guest lecturer today. He has a well-established career within the higher education sector with significant experience in stakeholder management, business development, international relations, and international marketing. So he has all the skills. He knows everything that he's going to be talking about, and he's going to share it with us. We are so fortunate, and today we're going to learn from him and get to know more about Macquarie University. All right, so please help me in giving a warm welcome to Macquarie University Director of Southeast Asia and Eurasia, Matt Monkhouse.
Thank you. Thank you. Delighted to be here and welcome everybody. Very happy to be here, and on behalf of BADA Philippines, thank you for organising this event today. My name is Matt Monkhouse, Director for Southeast Asia and Eurasia for Macquarie University. So wonderful to be with you today. And I guess today's presentation and what we're going to really be going through is discuss a little bit about the future of work. I think it's really important to understand some of the changes, what's happening. We hear a lot about this, but let's unpack it a little bit. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about study in Australia, and I guess how within Australian universities you are picking up these skills. And obviously for myself, working and being director of Macquarie University, I'm going to use the context of Macquarie University for this, but I think it's relevant across the board, and really see some of these interesting things happening in the world of work and how the world of work is changing. And I guess the takeaway point is there a lot of the time, you know, some of this information is, you know, can be a little bit sort of off-putting, but and scary for some students thinking, you know, what future careers, what's going to be there? But you've got to look at it. It's one of the most exciting times to be around. When you think about history, right now is one of the most exciting times. So I'm going to share my screen and we might get underway. So just let me set that up. Okay. So hopefully you can see that, and do let me know if there's any issues with sound or anything. We can drop something in and just to make sure that you can hear all okay.
Looks good, Matt.
Okay, wonderful. Well, let's get underway, and let's see if I can bring up the chat as well, so I can just keep an eye on anything that might pop up within the chat box. Okay, so couldn't start a presentation without looking at the COVID situation, could we? Obviously impacting us greatly around the world. Also here in Australia, whilst the Australian government has managed the COVID situation well, it continues to impact us in a number of ways. And of course, at the moment, you know, for not just Australia, but obviously keeping a close eye on what's happening in the Philippines and all through Southeast Asia, a place that I'm very close to. I travel to the Philippines on a regular basis. So I guess just to touch on the fact that, you know, as we know, there are travel restrictions in place all around the world. You know, for our students on Macquarie University at the moment, you know, there are some COVID cases happening through Australia. There's been, for those following the news, there are a couple of lockdowns in Sydney while they bring it back under control. But numbers and the situation in Australia has been managed very well. So we're very lucky in that sense. And with that, we are, of course, continuing to operate. And we have many of our students who are commencing online with us until the border restrictions do subside. So keep in mind, through, of course, today, something like 95% of our programs are available for online commencement, okay? And when we talk about online, it is, we have asynchronous and synchronous approach. So it's not just watching recorded lecture. These are really high quality online, subject delivery. So very interactive and high use of technology. So I just wanted to sort of start with that, just so you know that things are obviously still going on regardless. While COVID is difficult, things are very much still happening. And again, a little bit just, I'm gonna talk about Macquarie towards the end. We've got something like the next hour that we're going to be with you, and we'll allow some time for Q&A at the end as well. So don't worry about that. But of course, for Macquarie, I thought I'd better start. We are obviously a Sydney-based university, so I thought I'd throw this iconic picture up of Sydney just to give you a bit of context, and can't wait to see you all returning and coming to Sydney as soon as those border restrictions do come down. All right, but to start, Industry 4.0. What is Industry 4.0? When we talk about future-proof your career, the future of work, and we look at, I guess, you know, the industrial revolution and moving into Industry 4.0, or what are we actually saying? So you're looking at the fourth industrial revolution, in fact, when we look at Industry 4.0. So you think about, I won't go in detail, but just to put it in context for you, you think about the first industrial revolution, you know, moving in from, you know, that purely agrarian society into that industrial revolution, moving in from, you know, the early 1900s into steel production, oil, electricity coming in, telephone. So really those advancement of technologies coming in very quickly. Then from the 1980s, you know, the internet commencing and all of the things that the internet has brought, and those increased communication. So that digital revolution. Moving in now, right through to the fourth industrial revolution, and what is a really exciting time, you know, with Industry 4.0, and things are ramping up incredibly quickly here. Obviously, you know, when we look at Industry 4.0, you're thinking about robotics, artificial intelligence, that machine learning, of course, nanotechnology, quantum computing developing rapidly, the Internet of Things, that complete connectivity, 3D printing, another really interesting development, autonomous vehicles. And again, how does this impact us with work? What skills do you need to succeed in the future? What degree should you be doing? What should you be learning? How is this all going to, you know, factor in for you, who many of you today are obviously, you know, in that younger generation, younger than me, who are thinking about what should I do? What sort of degree or what area should I study that is not only going to give me a career, but that's going to actually keep you in work for, say, the next 20 years, because you're going to have to be adaptive, aren't you? So I thought with that, we might start off on a short video, which I think kind of shows some of this really well. So looking at some industries that you might not have thought of. So when you think of robotics and machine learning, it's happening in other areas where you may not have thought. So let's watch. Thank you. Some amazing thing that's happening, as you can see there. And I think it's also interesting that it's not only some of the sectors that, you know, you might automatically that come to mind. Like a lot of the time you think of, you know, perhaps data entry or perhaps, you know, banking and, you know, some of the more, I guess, you know, sort of computer or service orientated activities. But if you look at it there, it's happening right across construction. In Australia, we're very big in mining. Right now, a lot of the trucks that run around the mines are purely automated. So they are all on GPS sensors and they go back and forth on the mine sites completely driverless with someone sitting in a control room, perhaps in Sydney or in Melbourne, operating trucks remotely. So things are changing very quickly. So we can see on the left here, you know, it used to be highly, you know, populated manufacturing lines with people. So everybody had their own little job. Then we've now moved to robots, where again, you'll see someone behind a glass panel operating a console and completely sort of, automated production lines. For those who have been to Australia, particularly recently, you'll notice now in all our supermarkets that what we used to call checkouts, and you had a checkout operator like somebody on the left. In Australia now, it's all essentially self-service. So you basically have these stations, you walk up and you will scan your own groceries, you scan your own items, you basically tap your card or you tap your phone, you tap your watch, and then you basically walk out. You do it all yourself. So there's very few now staff there. It's all essentially automated. And Amazon are taking that one step further, where as soon as you pull the item off the shelf, it's basically being tapped onto your phone and going out. So again, you think of letters, we move to email, VHS cassettes, all these things that you can think about. We move into CD and then obviously to USB. And now everything is on chip and in the cloud. And again, you think of Netflix. Did you know Netflix, for those in the younger group here, Netflix started as a company that used to physically mail DVDs and video cassettes to people across America. Now look at Netflix, they're enormous. So this is how fast technology is changing. Look at the first computers moved down to laptops. Remember the old home office? You don't see too many home offices anymore. Again, someone like myself travel completely remote. So I'm lucky enough that I basically have a laptop and I have a phone and I can work anywhere. And particularly again with COVID, having those fixed offices, more and more we're all working remotely. So it's so important that all our things are stored in the cloud. We're moving away quicker and quicker from the standard office, whether that's at home or obviously in a high-rise type apartment. So the big question we always see is, will your job be stolen by a robot? The answer to that is maybe. So it depends, right? Because things are changing. But as I said at the start, it's really important not to be, I guess, worried about this or concerned. It's an exciting time. So I think it's such an exciting period for you to be looking at the jobs and looking at your skills and what you should be doing. Because I think, you know, you'll see these stats where a certain percentage of the jobs that are here today will be gone. And there's a big percentage of the jobs now, but perhaps particularly again for our younger attendees here, jobs now that you will be going into that don't even exist. You think of only a few years ago, if you were like a social media content curator or social media digital marketing manager, these jobs didn't exist. So they're coming up quicker and quicker. So the answer about a robot steal your job is it might. So you have to be prepared. You have to be ready. You have to think about, again, what you want to do and make sure you're looking in getting those skills that are going to keep you in a career, okay, that are going to keep you employable. So three biggest fears of our generation now, they've shifted. So all these days now, if you go anywhere, the first thing you're thinking is, am I connected? Can I connect to Wi-Fi? Do I have that signal? And can I charge my phone? When we leave in the morning, we don't go anywhere without our phone. And one of the first things we worry about, if we can't get a signal or connect, it's, what do we do? It's our biggest fear. So for those of you who have studied business previously, you'll know Maslow's hierarchy of needs. In 4.0, there's a new segment, isn't there? It's Wi-Fi. It's being able to connect to Wi-Fi. Incredibly important. So if it comes down to survival, or of course the bottom line used to be survival is in food. The first thing you'll do now if you go out, rather look for food and make sure you've got food, am I connected? So I think it's quite funny how that's kind of becoming a number one priority. We all know if you leave home in the morning or you lose your phone, you just feel something isn't right, is it? You really need that connectivity. And that becomes our, I think really, this is obviously tongue in cheek, but more and more it's becoming our number one priority is to make sure we are connected. So there's certainly some truth in that. There's no doubt about it. So how to succeed in the modern world. So when you're looking at degree structures, you're thinking about what you should study. You know, you think about engineering degree or perhaps a social science degree, a Bachelor of Arts. What skills do you need? Should you have hard skills? Should you have maths, you know, high problem solving skills, or the soft skills, communication, creativity, teamwork? And I'll touch a little bit more about what soft skills are. But again, you know, you're thinking about IT, engineering, very much in sciences. So looking at those hard skills, very important, right? Because we always see about technology. Technology is increasing. You've got to make sure you've got these hard skills in place. So should you be an expert in one area? In addition to that, hard and soft skills, should you be an expert, you know, very narrow, or a generalist? Should you know a little bit about everything, or high expertise in one particular area? Well, the answers in what we're looking at is, it's good to be an expert in one thing. So you do have, you know, that level of expertise in one key area, but you're capable of many. So I think it's really important when you're considering there that whilst the hard skills are very important, particularly making sure that you are, you know, what we call digital literate. So, you know, you have good, good digital skills, you know, and succeed in that particular area, problem solving skills, math is going to be good, of course. But more and more, the soft skills are coming in. So we have what here is called a T-shaped learning curve. So it's important that you have hard skills, but increasingly important that you have soft skills. So what we do, and I'll touch back on this, loop back into this towards the end, is what we'll do in the core generic skills that you should have is you've got this, you know, your IT and your digital literacy built through all the areas that you are learning, particularly within a university environment and then in your career environment. So in addition to those soft skills like communication, teamwork, problem solving, critical thinking, you know, ethical thinking, sustainability, emotional intelligence, you do have those digital skills because you're going to need those digital skills. But importantly, you'll see when you do any future skills or what do I need for future skills, you do a Google search, you will see that soft skills are more and more increasingly desired by employers because this is essentially what, so I guess when you look at it in a key way, the soft skills. So your technical skills may get you a job. So upon graduation, you're an engineer or you're an IT expert, you're a digital marketing professional, you've got your bachelor degree or you've got your master's degree, you know, you finish university, you've got your hard skills in place, you've got high expertise in that area that you've studied. But when you enter the work environment, what is going to put you and help you to increase and move and get that career progression into that, I guess, management or up into CEO area, it's your soft skills. And we see it all the time, what we call career derailment, where someone may be incredibly bright, they are very good in their hard skill area, they have high expertise in this technical ability, but if you have terrible soft skills or non-existent soft skills, you're not going to go very far with that. You may get a position, but you're really probably not going to climb that corporate ladder. And again, it's about lifelong learning. So things like, you know, those, as we see in the soft skills, leadership, communication, in those interpersonal skills, self-confidence, assertiveness. Again, we touched on ethics, resilience, incredibly important, self-resilience, conflict management, ability to problem solve. So these are all skills that you can learn and build upon. So I'm going to, again, loop back in at the end because what's important there is we embed these through the degree programs. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how we do that. So you're picking up your hard skills, but we're embedding these soft skills through degrees. Really important. So looking back to work, what's going to be the changes in that work environment? So you're thinking about automation, okay, machine learning, and you know, AI comes to mind as some of the first things, isn't it? So what you're going to see is those jobs where it's routine, manual tasks, those are the sort of positions that are essentially going to become obsolete, where, you know, you can automate, you know, these sort of key areas. You think of data entry, or we saw some of the examples previously, you know, with the construction sites, things that are sort of routine or essentially repetitive tasks, they are going to change and move to automation. So what you're going to need and what employers are going to want is people to spend more time on creativity, problem solving, okay? So when you're looking at those skills, enterprise skills is what they call, completely in demand. So things like communication, teamwork, ability to you know, do presentations, communication, creativity, critical thinking, really, really important for employers, okay, to be able to demonstrate that. So required skills then, you know, that analytical thinking, because you need to be able to think outside the box and solve problems, not spent on routine tasks. So if you're looking at stable roles, new roles, redundant roles, we'll go to the redundant roles first on the right, things that I touched on. So you think of data entry, accounting. Accounting's an interesting one. So there is still very much high demand on and for accountants. At Macquarie University, we're one of the largest accounting schools, not just in Australia, but in the world. But what we've seen is the, I guess, demand for accountants is actually growing, but the role of an accountant has very much changed. Long gone of the days of an accountant who was sitting there for hours crunching numbers and basically going through and doing complex equations. The role of an accountant now is more as an advisor, really making sure, you know, wealth management. I spoke about that creativity and communication. So whilst it's important that an accountant understands the terminology and knows the legal and complex environment of an accountant, but that number crunching days are gone. They are now advising and coming up with creative ways, legal, creative ways, of course, for accountants to generate wealth management. So that's just a really interesting one there. As you go through, you'll see, I think, mechanics, telecommunications installers, bank tellers. We're seeing particularly sales, I guess, you know, McDonald's was another example there. So I'm thinking all these sorts of positions are slowly, slowly diminishing. So when you look at new roles, data analysts, scientists, obviously, anything within IT, within fintech, within engineering is all up and coming. But it's not just in that technical world, okay? So still things like, you know, sales managers who are dealing with people, they're still going to stay. Risk management specialists, IT specialists, medical professionals. Again, the role is changing, but there's going to be some exciting things coming up in that area. So I think it's important that you're just sort of looking at and thinking about when you're looking at what should I study, what degree should I do, what is changing, and will that position be there in 10, 15, 20 years time? Because a lot of you are probably around the 20 year or younger age mark. So there's going to be some incredible opportunities for you, but some significant change. So again, emerging occupations. You'll see digital obviously embedded across a lot of this. Data analytics, you know, business coaches, again, things like that regulatory, sustainability, engineering, IT, all going to be growing. So this is sort of the areas that, you know, you need to be thinking about. But if, you know, you're still looking at some of the social sciences or arts, doesn't mean that you're going to be out of the job if you're looking at those programs. Still lots of opportunities there for you because, again, there's a lot of soft skill development in those. So again, talking today, looking at studying overseas, I think this is one of the really interesting things where studying overseas is a way to really automatically build soft skills without you even realizing. So you're going to a university to study, pick up your essentially more of your hard skills, but studying overseas builds, it gives you that international experience, it broadens your horizon, communication skills automatically develop. You need to be independent because you're moving from your home environment to a new environment, so that independence automatically is built in you. Not so much for Philippines, of course, but you know, being immersed in, and for many, being immersed in a fully English-speaking environment like Australia, building your resume, much more attractive to employers. If you've been able to demonstrate that, hey, I'm from the Philippines, I've come to Australia, I've finished my degree, you can obviously navigate your way around the world. You've been able to move to a new country. You know, that says a lot about you, your confidence, your assertiveness to be able to do that and succeed. And then just obviously those networks becoming global. It's amazing. And you see the difference. I'm lucky where I talk to students on the first day, they come up and say, oh, look, I'm thinking about studying overseas. I'm not sure. Then, you know, you cut back to the end of their bachelor or master. You see the change in that person. It's amazing, just that confidence and that assertiveness. So it really does, you know, change for sure. Of course, today we're talking about Australia. So we're going to be looking at the Australian context and particularly about Macquarie as well. So Australia, we've been doing this for a long time. We have many students who come from all over the world to study in Australia. It's where, you know, the third largest international student destination. And, you know, we have many reasons or there's many reasons why students are choosing Australia. Not only is it a great place to live, a great place of study, there's many favourable Australian government policies in place there. Things like streamlined visa processing, the ability to have a post-study work period. So you study in Australia, you can stay back in Australia on completion of your study. Safety, lifestyle, very low crime in Australia. High, very strong economy, very low unemployment, the ability to work part-time while you're in Australia. The minimum starting salary is $20 per hour. So even if for younger students who may not have any previous work experience, you're working part-time in retail and hospitality, minimum $20 per hour, okay? So it's also, you know, high starting salaries in Australia again. Then I guess all the things we have in place, you know, to ensure a high quality experience. So Macquarie University.
Hello, everyone. I'm not sure if I think we lost Matt for a while. All right. So let's just allow Matt to come back. I guess he had some technical difficulty on his end. Yeah. But in the meantime, while you're waiting, I hope you're enjoying the session. If you've captured some questions already that you'd like to address, feel free to type them in the chat function. And so that later we can address them once our speaker is back. So this is what live sessions really go through these days. So I hope so far you've learned from Matt the things that he discussed about soft skills and hard skills, they're still important. And he also mentioned the T curve. What's interesting, guys, is what he mentioned about Maslow's theory, the hierarchy. He already, if you noticed, he added at the bottom the Wi-Fi level, which is not originally in the hierarchy of Maslow. For the teachers in the room, I think you could definitely relate to that. But would you agree to what he said? Okay. All right. I think our guest speaker is back. Hi, Matt.
I'm not sure what happened there, but I seem to have a bit of a failure in internet, but I am back. So
no worries.
We'll
wait for you to share your screen again. Sure.
And we shall continue. So yeah, my sincere apologies there, but let's go again.
No worries, Matt. Okay. Thank you.
I was just touching on Sydney. So just to be back, it's just touching on Sydney and just saying basically, for Sydney, for those of you who have been to Sydney, you'll appreciate, again, multiculturalism there, but great environment, clean air, no pollution. It's really what we're, Sydney as, I guess, the corporate and commercial capital of Australia, okay? So while Canberra is our administrative capital, Sydney is really, you know, I guess, deemed the commercial corporate. So for graduate positions on completion of your degree, you've got your post-study work, staying in Sydney is where you're going to find a lot of your graduate positions and, you know, really be able to get a great start. And of course, it's really just one of the, I guess, the most dynamic city in Australia as well. Fantastic place to be. As I mentioned, very low unemployment, very strong economy, lots of opportunities in Sydney. And then I'll talk a little about transportation networks and things like that as we develop as well. Okay, so. So for Macquarie University, so again, we are an Australian university, of course. So we have a beautiful campus in the northern part of Sydney, in the North Shore of Sydney, Macquarie Park. And we are located on 126 hectare, so very green open campus, right in the middle of the largest high-tech precinct in Australia, actually in the Southern Hemisphere. So we're surrounded by 300 companies, many of those multinational companies. So for us, it means great access to internships and graduate positions. So when I come back to those practical skills and how to get a job, we'll touch a little bit more again on internships as well. A really key important part, okay? So really important there. Then for the university, we have our own subway station. So we're connected to the Greater Sydney Transportation Network, Macquarie University Station. So we have this basically underground metro, high-speed driverless trains every 4 minutes. So we're talking about the future of work and about automation. So the metro in Sydney, the trains, they do not have drivers. So they come every 4 minutes and there is no driver. So you jump on the train, you can stand right at the front where the driver used to be, and you can actually just sit there. It's quite amazing. So again, with Macquarie, top 1% globally, ranked 200 in the world. But one of the, I guess, rankings or metrics that we're really proud of is the number one in Australia for employment rate, or 28th globally for graduate employment rate, which means our students get jobs. So this is again coming back to that importance of that practical experience, those soft skills, to make sure that graduates are getting jobs. Because again, you're going to university, the ultimate outcome and why you're going to university is to land your dream career. Whilst it's a great experience at university, the plan is that it's going to set you up for life and put you in that dream career, isn't it? So a little bit on campus. I'm not going to touch on this too much because I have a short video that I'm going to play for you. And this is really going to highlight the campus. So I'm just going to play this for you now.
Welcome to Macquarie University. Did you know that when the Macquarie campus was established more than 50 years ago, it was done with collaboration at its heart? Our visionary founders chose a bold location away from the city centre, but an area where they predicted Sydney would boom. And they weren't wrong. Our stunning 126-hectare campus is uniquely located in the heart of not only Australia's, but the Southern Hemisphere's largest high-tech precinct. Such a location enables you to connect and collaborate with future employers in some of the country's leading organisations while you're still studying. Through internships and other practical work experiences, as well as through degrees that have been co-designed with industry partners, you'll gain the knowledge and skills you'll need to meet the current and future challenges of your chosen profession. Okay, so it's great that there's an amazing hub of innovation right next door to the campus, but what about the actual campus? Having had more than $1 billion invested in the campus in recent years, Macquarie is home to some of Australia's most exceptional facilities. Our newest building, One Central Courtyard, is where you're going to love spending a lot of your on-campus downtime. Standing atop grassed and paved courtyards, this central hub is home to the iconic U-Bar, as well as 16 food outlets. There's also an awesome terrace that overlooks the lake. Yep, we have a lake. It's also home to our new on-campus student residential accommodation, which features studio, twin, and apartment options, communal social areas, and 24/7 on-campus security. If you're in need of some quiet study time, you'll most likely head to the library. Only 10 years old, the library provides access to millions of print and electronic resources. It features group and quiet study areas, computers, printers and copiers, presentation practice pods, and a cafe. And if you're into sport and fitness, you're going to love our Sport and Aquatic Centre, which features two pools, a gym, courts, and fields. Now, you're probably wondering what specific facilities are available in your area of study. If you're an arts, law, or linguistics student, you're going to seriously enjoy studying in our world-leading spaces. Our new arts precinct features flexible classroom spaces, a language centre, museums, a cafe, atrium, and rooftop garden. Our linguistics department offers one of the best equipped research and clinical environments in the world, and we're home to the Macquarie Social Justice Clinic. If you're studying education, you may have access to training through the Mia Mia Child and Family Study Centre, the Special Education Centre, or the Next Sense Institute. As a business student, you'll have access to our Finance Decision Lab, a collaborative space that facilitates hands-on financial market simulations and workshops. If you're studying engineering, you'll have opportunities to get involved with real projects, like working on a go-kart or the MQ Speed Team's human-powered vehicle. If IT, games design, app development, or cybersecurity are your thing, you'll be kept busy in our industry-leading computing precinct with cybersecurity, networking, and gaming labs. For Media Buffs, you'll hone your skills in our multi-million dollar media hub with professional screen, recording, music, radio, and performance studios, and an industry-standard digital newsroom. If you're undertaking a health, medical, or psychology degree, you could be studying alongside experts from MQ Health and Cochlear, or within our simulation hub, anechoic chamber, or even our on-campus hospital, physiotherapy suites, or new clinical education building. As a science student, you can't do much better than studying in some of the best physics, molecular sciences, biology, and environment labs in Asia Pacific. And one last facility that's very important to us is the Wollongomoo Pavilion. Macquarie recognises the custodianship of the land on which our campus is situated. The Wallamadigal clan of the Darug Nation and the Wollongomoo Pavilion is a gathering place for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students, staff and visitors. So, that's our campus. But how do I get from one facility to the next, you ask? That will be down Wally's Walk, named after Macquarie architect planner Dr. Walter Abraham. This central pathway runs the entire length of the university and links all of our amazing facilities. I'm sure you'll agree, our campus is pretty spectacular. We can't wait to see you here sometime soon. To book a campus tour, visit mq.edu.au/campus-tours.
All right, so that really just highlights a little bit of the university and I guess also points to some of the facilities, of course, but also some of the areas of study. So looking at programs, so you're in a really, you know, again, as I keep saying, envious position because you've got the whole world in front of you. You're thinking of taking on a degree. There's so many different things for you to consider. So the nature of work is changing. We've discussed that. Study is also changing. So when you look at the degrees, they're now, you know, simplified. So there's a lot more flexibility in choosing subjects, designing your own degree, real world. So more practical experience in there, personalized, and of course, better value to make sure, because it's all about that investment, isn't it? It's an investment into your future. So when we look at that, we spoke about picking up all those skills into the degrees. But you look at the areas of study. So at Macquarie University, we've got something like 400 degree programs, and they span across a wide range in areas of study. So things like art, social sciences, and business, to security, intelligence. We spoke about all those key areas. So there's a lot of different things that you can consider there when you're looking at what degree you want to study. So again, I would encourage you to go to our website, talk to BADA. BADA, as Macquarie University's official representative, can really give you good detailed advice on what programs are available, depending on which areas you want to study. And if you don't know, then we can still have a chat and give you guidance, because there's so many things for you to consider there. And then of course, we look at ranking. So again, the programs are very well ranked. So at Macquarie, whilst we're the top 1% of universities globally, a lot of our subject rankings are much higher. So I'm gonna spend the last couple of minutes, we've only got about sort of 5 minutes or 5 to 10 minutes to go before we'll open up for a bit of Q&A, just on that practical experience and looking at, I guess, you know, what sort of programs. Again, length, duration, you're looking at undergraduate, master degree programs, but then the skills within the programs that are going to ultimately get you your jobs. So undergraduate degrees are going to generally be 3 years in duration. Engineering, psychology, some of your medical degrees are going to be 4 years in duration. For your master degree programs, we have 1 year masters available. We also have 2 year double degree or 2 year double masters available, okay, that are 2 years in duration. But we do also have some other programs that are straight 2 years in duration. So this is important when you're looking at your post-study work outcomes for those of you who may be interested in studying in Australia, but of course then staying back in Australia and building your experience and looking at graduate positions and then staying in Australia for a little bit longer. Or of course you can return straight back to the Philippines, or you can use your newly acquired internationally recognized degree from a university that's in the top 1% globally to go anywhere across the world, of course, and it's recognised. Again, we have things like master path options where you can package bachelor and master degree programs, finish in 4 years. So again, I think for some and many universities in Philippines and globally, your standard bachelor is going to be 4 years. At a university like Macquarie, you can actually do your bachelor in 3 years and then a one-year master's packaged. So within 4 years, you graduate with a bachelor and a master degree program. So very, very good for students. And general entry requirements, so we do recognize and have direct entry from many Philippine high schools. If you don't meet direct entry, we do have alternate pathways. Again, BADA are by far the best people to consult with on that. They can give you all the correct advice on entry requirements and what do I need, and even more importantly, how do I apply? Okay, so that's really key as well that you're talking. Again, for Philippines, for Macquarie University, we don't require IELTS, only for very specialized degrees. So for most of our degree programs, we won't need you to have an English language examination like an IELTS. You can get direct entry. It's only for specialist programs, and this isn't just for the Philippines, this is globally. For things like the Macquarie MD program, medical doctor program, and psychology, and some others where it's required, not by the university, but by the Australian government or the accrediting body. Post-study work, again, such a really key thing for Australia, which allows our international students the ability to stay back on completion of your degree, really important. And then I guess the other thing is to touch on is research. So for Macquarie University, very much a research intensive university. So anyone here today interested in PhD, we do have opportunities for PhD students, but for our bachelor and master students, it's also important because what this means is you have professors who are absolute experts in their field. They're making international groundbreaking discoveries. They're publishing in international journals. They're speaking at international conferences, absolute experts in their field. And then they're in the classroom teaching you. So you get direct access to them. So really, really important from that sense. Scholarships. So again, for those, you know, thinking of study, we have what's called the Macquarie University ASEAN Scholarship. So this is a tuition waiver, which is $10,000 per year for duration of your program. So this is for students from the Philippines or actually from the ASEAN region, of course, Philippines, member state of ASEAN network, means $10,000 per year duration of study. So very simple, you study a program that's 4 years in duration, it's going to be an automatically granted $40,000 scholarship to you, okay? If it's 2 years, $20,000 scholarship. So very, very simple. The only qualifying feature is you're commencing in either 21 or 2022, and of course your Philippine nationality. Now we have many other scholarships, but we encourage you again to talk to BADA Philippines about the scholarships that are available. They are also listed on the Macquarie website. Because I want to wrap up in the next couple of minutes so we can have a bit of a chat. But you'll see at Macquarie, we have what's called the Student Success Strategic Framework. So a really important framework that makes sure, looks after, I guess, the journey or I guess the life long learning area for our students. So right from day one, your orientation, you're going to go through basically a pathway that's going to give you success to graduate and find that dream job, okay? So all the things we spoke about, building those soft skills, picking up those 21st century skills, that digital literacies, competencies in the soft skills and those character qualities that employers need. So we make sure and we do a lot of work to embed these into the degree programs that we have, okay? So every single degree program will have these embedded. And what that's really important as well, extracurricular, things like professional and community engagement, our internationally award-winning PACE program, global leadership programs, the ability to study abroad, meaning you're coming from the Philippines, you come to Australia, you're coming to Macquarie University. We have outbound scholarships. We can see you have a semester experience abroad in another country. You might go to Brazil, you might go to the USA, you might go to Europe. So we have all these experiences that are again going to help you. And obviously I've mentioned and touched on internships. Every single degree program at Macquarie will have an internship option available for students. So really, really important. We help students get jobs through our careers and employment division. They are part-time jobs. That's also graduate positions as well. Then just really quickly, accommodation. We have many accommodation options on campus. So you can actually live right on campus. Then this student experience, so you're there, you're studying, we spoke about soft skills and all these things, but one of the really important things is that you are enjoying yourself and you've got that work-life balance. So you're in Australia, you need to enjoy that Australian lifestyle, Australian culture. And Macquarie University, we're a university of 40,000 students, 11,000 international students from 120 different nationalities. So it's a little city itself, okay? So you can imagine just how vibrant it is with that. Clubs, societies, all these things. Then, of course, all the orientation, O-Week things that we offer. We'll come and pick you up from the airport. So many organized activities for you outside of your degree program. And then student support, so much support for you, whether it's, you know, academic or social, 24-hour access for assistance. We have a really active Filipino student society on campus. Again, if you're thinking of studying in Australia or at Macquarie, we'd certainly encourage you to reach out to them. They are wonderful. So they can tell you what it's like for a student from the Philippines to come to Macquarie, to Sydney, and give you that firsthand experience. They're very active with their activities. So I've just got one more video and then we're actually going to finish up.
Well, I studied, I got a Bachelor of Science degree in Human Geography, of all things. It's an amazing degree, and one that I have to admit that I didn't pick initially. And so when I managed to really sit down and think about it, I realized, hey, this is something that I enjoy. I enjoy learning about different cultures. I enjoy learning about socioeconomic political systems. This is what really interests me, and this is what I'm doing well at. So maybe I should follow my passion, and that's exactly what I did. I changed my major to human geography, and that, ladies and gentlemen, is what I graduated in. And I tell you what, the human geography course at Macquarie University is fantastic. Travel is one of the best educations you can get in the world. So combining travel with an actual formal education is a fantastic tie-up. I found that traveling around the world, I've lived in, I think, 7 countries so far. Traveled to over 50. And what you learn from traveling and actually living in a different country, and in this case, learning in a different country, is something that you can't learn at home. You get to understand other people's cultures, their different attitudes, and you get to respect that. Now, if you are living in a different culture, living in a different country, learning in a different country, then you can appreciate everything that it goes on and the thought processes that go behind that. So once you understand it, then you're not afraid of it anymore. Well, if there were any tips that I could give to students who are thinking of studying in Australia, well, one really springs to mind. Do it. Honestly, there is, don't even hesitate. If you have the opportunity, then make sure you take it. The things that you will learn, number one, at the university, it's a different style of learning. The campus, for instance, at Macquarie is like none you have ever experienced. It is enormous. There is nature everywhere. The facilities are first class. You're meeting people from all over the world. You're expanding your network. You're getting the very best education that that money can buy. And you're living and experiencing a different country and a different culture. If you go to Australia and you're studying there, it's going to be a very different lifestyle. It kind of forces you to grow up, to mature, and this is a really good thing. It teaches you to become more independent. You can rely on yourself. You're not relying on other people. And this will translate to being just, I guess, more free to travel anywhere in the world, work anywhere in the world, and know that you can always rely on yourself. There are so many great experiences you can have in Australia. If you've never been there, I highly recommend you go and check it out. It is a beautiful, beautiful city, full of wonderful people. The food is amazing, and make sure you have a meat pie. Every time I go back to Australia, my first meal has to be a meat pie. It's the equivalent of adobo for Filipinos. It's something that every Aussie knows. Okay, and loves.
So I'm going to finish up there. I thought we... It's nice to just hear from Mark at the end there, just on his experiences at Macquarie as well. So I'll hand back over to you, Monette. So thank you to everybody, though, and hope we've got a little bit of time for Q&A. And I think one of the key things for me is I'm sure, obviously, we won't be able to answer all your questions today, but we would be happy to continue and organise another just time that we can actually chat with you as well. But thank you, everybody, for your time, and I hope that was valuable.
All right. Thank you, Matt. Awesome. So we do have some questions for you, Matt, but before I proceed with our Q&A, I would like to first thank you for that excellent presentation. And I want to share this quick video to everyone so they have a quick glimpse of how Macquarie can actually empower them once they step into the university. So please watch this.
Answers to the world's biggest questions are out there. When you connect with another and another, things just... That's you, to the power of us. It's a human equation that puts you at the heart of everything we do. It means knocking down the walls that limit us. So you can talk to an archaeologist, an artist, a radiographer, to look in the past for the answers of tomorrow. It means letting the ideas out of your head so others can shape them and run with them. To make a surfer invisible, to make retirement living decisions simple, to have a fish teach us to cure motor neuron disease. It means together we can make a synthetic yeast help billions. And it means that working with them lets her hear you. Because when you're powered by our collective, you become more than just you. You become you to the power of us. Macquarie University.
Okay, wasn't it very emotional and empowering, especially that scene when somebody just heard something for the first time? Wow, amazing. So for our Q&A, yep, Matt, you wanted to say something?
I was going to say, it really is incredible. So we have the Australian Hearing Hub on campus, and there's some incredible footage where exactly as you said, Monette, it is where people are actually hearing for the very first time. So they're being fitted with cochlear implants, which isn't a hearing aid. So this is actually where it's connected. It's a surgical procedure. And as you said, they're switching on digitally, and we've seen it happen, can do it remotely, where they basically press a button and all of a sudden that person is hearing for the first time ever. I mean, what an incredible thing.
Amazing. Yeah. Wow. I want to be part of that kind of discovery. So Matt, for your first question, this is quite long. I'll start with the long one. So a student whose background is into multimedia design, what will be your recommended double masters? Currently, I think the student is looking at Master of Marketing and Master of Media and Communications. Yeah. So would it be better to do an IT-related master's, especially considering the future opportunities?
I guess that depends. And I guess, you know, we could have a deeper discussion on that. But just quickly, I guess if the student, you know, if you've already got a background in media and communication, you've kind of got some of your hard skills there. And I guess it depends on how recently you studied and, you know, if you're just sort of completing and, you know, if you feel you've got good talent there and you've got really good skills in that digital, you know, the use of technology within media and communication, you're competent in your field, then of course you could go into, again, a Master of Media and Communication and further build your skills and knowledge in there. Or you could be moving into something like, you know, the options are to, again, move straight into that, but you would also be eligible to go into things like a Master of Management, a Master of International Business, a Master of Marketing. So you can diversify your skills a little bit as well. So someone from that background, as I said, would be eligible for a Master of Marketing, a Master of Management, or even the double degree option of Marketing and Management, or Media and Communication. So, you know, some good possibilities there. And I think you'd probably have to have a little bit of a think about your career aspirations, what you want to do, but could certainly, you know, continue on and develop further skills and diversify your skill area, or go into more of a management style degree to assist you into, I guess, also developing your skills in the business world. So if you wanted to go out, start your own business, start your own agency, you know, you could look at something like that. If you've got aspirations to perhaps try and, you know, work for Google or a corporation, then you could continue to build your skills. So lots of opportunities there, but some really good opportunities.
Great. So there's a lot of options, actually.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, Matt. Absolutely. So for the person who asked this question, my I guess for BADA Philippines, our suggestion is we can talk about it and perhaps we can assist you and narrow down these options and align it to what your future goals are. Right?
I think that's the good advice on it. I think because it'd probably be good to have a bit of a deeper discussion. We could unpack some of the majors, because when I talk about, you know, going into the business world, even within our Master of Media and Communication, you can choose electives from our School of Business. So you can still develop, subjects within management or subjects within marketing, or whether it's in basic, whatever it might be in the business world. So you can still pick up those skills.
Great. Thank you, Matt. From Lim Yi Su, I hope I pronounced it right. She said she's interested, or he is interested, for a master program and asking what are the majors for psychology?
So for psychology, so we are top 100 globally in psychology. I think we're sitting around number 70 globally. So very strong in psychology. So we have a master of clinical psychology and a master of clinical neuropsychology, and also a master of organizational psychology at the postgraduate level. Keep in mind there, not just for Macquarie University, but for any Australian university, if you're coming into a master of psychology, you have to have an undergraduate degree that is accredited by the Australian Psychological Association. So we can look at that. So we, in our department, we kind of determine your undergraduate psychology degree and your ability to sort of enter into the master, but that's, again, something we can look into. That's a pretty standard process for us. So yeah, short answer to the question is clinical psychology, neuroclinical psychology, and organizational psychology.
Okay, so you have three options.
Yes.
All right. Next one is from Jacqueline Matt. The university is great, she said, and appreciates the study option to go online. So are you able to elaborate on synchronous and asynchronous program?
And yeah, absolutely. Very, very good question. Yep.
There are actually three, so synchronous and asynchronous. What are the program courses that the university offers? An estimate timeline to finish it? Okay. And is it a requirement to have a student visa?
Really good question. So remind me if I miss any there on it, but really, really good question. So obviously with COVID, you know, we understand that, globally there's impacts on all of us for travel and particularly, of course, for international students at the moment. But the really good thing is, of course, as I mentioned, Australia is really getting COVID, they've managed it very well. So we're expecting our international students to look to start to return, particularly into early 2022. But there is the ability for students to commence online, absolutely. So when we're looking at online, you spoke about synchronous and asynchronous. So gone are the days of, you know, when some people think of online, it's just sitting in watching like a recorded lecture that, you know, might pop up and it's, you know, not very interactive at all. So synchronous, asynchronous, meaning that they can be live. So all our lectures are actually available live. And for students, particularly in Southeast Asia or the Philippines, because of Australia, the time difference is only 2 hours. So it's not, it's very easy, particularly for students, to jump into live lectures because the time zone is very user-friendly. So how it works is, you're commencing online. We use Zoom and lots of other technology where, you know, you basically get all your information sent to you. You are participating in a live lecture. So you've got your academic there who is live in front of you. It's interactive. We use a lot of technology and software, you know, for different online quizzes. So, I mean, all done live. So different quizzes and polling. So you can actually participate, you know, results. It's what do you think about this? And you can actually move on your screen, different levers to show, you know, your thoughts and different things. So it is live. You're interacting with your students. Of course, you know, you can go into breakout rooms and you're actually working on, you know, group tasks and different things. Very, very interactive. Now, of course, then the asynchronous bit is, of course, that you can go back and watch these live lectures. So we have what's called iLearn. It's a bit like, I guess you can kind of maybe sort of relate it to, say, Netflix, where you would go in and you'd have all your lectures are there and stored. So you can go back in. So if you're working or you're busy, or of course, as you're leading up to an examination, you might want to go back and watch some of those again. So you can go in and you can just watch them on demand. So you can just say, okay, I want to watch lecture from week 2 in Marketing 101. You just click on that and it's going to replay for you on demand for you. So the technology we use is very, very good. The online learning experience is very, very good. So students have access to all this through their online system. And I actually can speak on this firsthand because I'm actually doing my MBA with Macquarie and I'm actually studying online at the moment as well. So I'm doing what's called our global MBA. It's a fully online MBA. So I'm personally halfway through that MBA studying online. I love it. Wow. It gives me flexibility. I jump in the evening at 6 p.m. I jump into the lecture. I meet all my colleagues from all around the world. When I say colleagues, students, my fellow students from all around the world. And we have a chat and got the lecturer and we're all interacting and doing case studies. So it's a really enjoyable experience. The second part of your question there was, or I'll jump onto the third, is do I need a visa? The answer is technically you don't need a visa to commence online, but we strongly encourage students to get a visa. The reason for that is a couple of reasons. One, post-study work. So the Australian government, as I mentioned through my presentation, Australia has what's called post-study work, which is a two-year stay-back period. So you study for 2 years, you get an automatic a stay-back in Australia for 2 years on completion of your degree, okay? So you've got to study a program 2 years or longer in duration, you get a two-year stay-back in Australia. Then, of course, you can apply to stay longer through PR and other processes, but you automatically get that post-study work. So what the Australian government has said that if you're commencing online from your home country, as long as you've got your student visa, any study that is done online from your home country will be counted towards your post-study work visa. So that's why we strongly encourage students to get their visa. Then the other thing with that is beneficial. If you're starting online and you've got your visa, the minute that the travel restrictions come down, you can travel. You've already got your visa. You've got everything in place. Right. You can jump on the very next plane. And as I mentioned, these are live lectures. So the lectures that you're doing online, say from Philippines, are exactly the same as what students all around the world and in Australia are doing. So you can jump on a plane and be in the same lecture the very next day, so to speak, because it is the same content, the same structure. So there's a couple of reasons why we strongly guarantee or strongly recommend students to get their visa. There was a third question. Which one did I miss? Oh, I think it was, I just wanted to touch on that also, study load. So again, if you're commencing online from offshore, you can study anywhere between 1 and 4 units. So for students, international students in Australia, as part of your student visa requirement, you need to study what's called a full-time study load, which is 4 subjects per semester, two semesters per year, so 8 subjects a year, okay? So 4 subjects per semester, 2 semesters per year. That's part of your visa, but if you're offshore studying from home, you can study anywhere between 1 and 4 units. You do not have to do a full-time study load. So it's a wonderful way for students just to be able to, you know, use their time wisely to commence their degree, lock in scholarship, lock in program, then you're all ready to go as soon as those borders open. And I think I missed, there was one more, wasn't there, that I missed there, I think. So you had visa, the asynchronous and the synchronous.
The estimated timeline, I think you...
Yeah, timeline, estimated timeline. So estimated timeline on your degree program, that's flexible. So again, if you're studying a 2-year program, you can obviously still do that in 2 years if you're studying a full-time study load. But if you're studying only one subject a semester from offshore, then that's going to mean that you can actually just do that one subject in Philippines, and you're still going to be doing, say, 2 full years in Australia. So you can kind of adjust it to suit, and it's really a personal thing at that point for flexibility. Timeline, as far as when we would expect to see international students return, the really good news in Australia now is the vaccination rates are increasing very quickly. So, you know, we're confident that we'll start to see international students returning before the end of this year, and then, you know, much more open into 2022.
Great. So for those who are aspiring also to study in Australia, I hope you're getting your vaccines also. Okay. Yes. And last 2 questions, Matt, we're running out of time, but I'm happy to just throw in this second question.
Yeah.
Another question, do you offer a curriculum or education for students who are deaf and mute? Because I think it would be very helpful for his research proposal for his master's degree.
Yeah, interesting. Yes, we do. So we have many students who will study with us with various disabilities. So we have all sorts of things in place to be able to assist with students who are coming in with disabilities. So happy to, you know, look into that further, and I can connect you with the right people on campus who can give you some good advice about how that may work and how we, I guess, deliver and prepare curriculum for students who may have special requirements. So, but the short answer is yes.
Okay, there's your answer, Arias. So why don't you communicate with us and let's have a chat to further explore this. And one final question for today, Matt. This is from Dr. Jacob, I believe. I'm not sure, but she said, what will Macquarie University will achieve in the present occurrence and especially the futures beyond? So I guess he's asking for future plans of Macquarie.
Yeah, look, it's, I mean, at Macquarie, you know, we When you look at our research, plan, our research strategy, it is research and interactions to change the world. So, you know, and we're doing that. We have big aspirations through our research to, again, impact and have discoveries that do change the world. And I think we've already done that and we'll continue to do that. One of the interesting things when we look at, Macquarie, that you may not know is today we're all using technology that was developed at Macquarie. Although I earlier had some issues and apologies again for my internet dropping out. But Macquarie University, we were integral in the invention of Wi-Fi. So Macquarie University actually invented the very first wireless chip. So professors in our engineering department, our telecommunications engineering department, we were the first university, and they were the first group of researchers through a company called Radiata to actually send packets of data wirelessly. So we developed the technology, and the chip that's in your computer and your phone was very much, it's been refined and obviously developed to a much higher level, but it was developed at Macquarie University. We ended up patenting that with the CSIRO, the Australian government, and selling that technology to a company called Cisco, who went on again, developed it to what we have today. So that, I think, is a huge thing that Macquarie's done around the world. We looked at cochlear before, Monette. You spoke about that young lady in the video who is hearing for the first time. We have, you know, joint professors with cochlear. We have our hospital on campus. We are doing amazing work and discoveries in the medical world where, you know, we are fusing surgical kind of special metals into bone to fit new prosthetics, so to make people walk again. So we're doing these incredible things and really groundbreaking stuff. So in addition to teaching, you know, the latest and updated things in accounting or fintech, you know, particularly obviously the medical world, psychology, medicine, education, you know, we're doing some absolutely groundbreaking things. And, you know, when we've got as a research intensive university like Macquarie is, not only are we researching and making groundbreaking discoveries, you know, as I said in my presentation, students are then coming into the classroom with access to those professors.
Right. Thank you, Matt. And I think we've answered the last question, but I just would like to ask, Matt, I think you will be having an open day sometime in August. Is this something we can announce or we can invite?
Yeah, well, not yet, but I thought what we would do is we would certainly can do something and establish some, if any students that we have in or prospective students, anyone in today who would like to have a further discussion, then we're happy to organise a further interview session with BADA Philippines, and we can have more of a one-on-one, and if students are happy to contact BADA Philippines, then we can coordinate suitable times to meet and have a bit more of an in-depth chat. So we can definitely put a day aside and we can notify what would be suitable time to have a more, one-on-one chat about your future study options, career options, and you know what programs you're thinking, and work with BADA Philippines on that.
Great, thank you, Matt. So that's great. We are now complete. We have completed our Q&A. Thank you very much. And I've posted the e-certificate request form. I hope you were able to click the link and already send your request so you can receive it within the next few days, next week. So we've answered the last question. Allow me now to conclude this session by thanking everyone for joining. We hope you learned and this influence you to have this global mindset, you know, growing and being global. Okay, so thank you to our guest speaker, Matt, for driving our attention to the industry shifts that are happening today. Because, you know, having the knowledge of the right skills will definitely help us transition better, you know, better to the fourth revolution as we progress into our chosen careers. And of course, thank you to all our attendees. You've been very warm and participative and early. Now is the time to empower your future with Macquarie University. Please visit their website, www.mq.edu.au. Let's plan your studies for your Australian student application needs. BADA Philippines is your trusted agent here in Manila, and we are happy to assist everyone, even those offshore. So I think we saw someone from Malaysia. Our team also in Sydney, Australia, is happy to assist. So schedule your one-on-one consultation, contact philippines@bada.edu.com, visit our website www.bada.edu.com, and select Philippine branch. Let's plan your studies, and in the meantime, stay home, stay safe. We're all in this together. Thank you, Matt. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
Goodbye.
Thank you.